Hi, everyone. My name is Jasmine Jasmine. I am a sophomore at River Valley High School. The topic that I choose is land uses, agriculture versus development. I agree that more land should be used for agriculture. As you see, according to debate.org, 62% of people agree that land should be used for agriculture because there are many businesses that create pollution, but agriculture does not create pollution. Do you know how many people died because of pollution? Let me tell you. According to debate.com, more than 3 million people died because of pollution, and almost factories create that pollution. Agriculture does not affect people. Usually, agriculture keeps our environment clean and save many people's lives. People are just selling their lands, cutting trees and making buildings. I know it's too good to have a buildings because we are a new generation. But according to time.com, 50 billion trees cut last year. Trees give us oxygen, and we are cutting those trees. If it continues like that, then we all have to face a problem in the future. So try to grow trees as many as you can because trees cannot affect you. Second, agriculture is a gold mine for everyone. According to unrise.com, they interviewed 55 farmers who said that they live because of agriculture, and they said crops and land is their goal. Look, we grow vegetables, we grow crops or beans, even fruits from trees. Think what will happen when there will be no beans and no vegetables. That is, we will all starving if we have money or we don't have money. For example, my family and I is depend on farming. If there is going to no farming, then me and my family will be starving. That's why agriculture is very important for many people. Lastly, for many people, agriculture is a source of livelihood. According to WorldBank.com, states that agriculture is a livelihood of 70% people. You know what? If you are taking those land to build buildings, then you are taking 70% people's lives. For example, most of the Indian and the Mexican people didn't study much. They only know about farming. People who have studied, they can work anywhere. So agriculture is a many of us life, and no one would like to take away their life. In conclusion, I totally agree that land should be used for agriculture rather than development, because agriculture does not create pollution. Agriculture is a gold mine for everyone. So try to develop farming if you can and do not build more buildings on the land we have. Thank you.
California achieved statehood September 9, 1840, mostly due to the gold rush in the Sierra Nevada mountains. Californians dreamed of a state based on equal representation and freedoms within their government. However, as the state developed a largely growing population in Southern California, we noticed that Southern Californians seem to have gained a larger say in establishing government policies. More and more of California's representatives were also chosen from the South, and this trend continues today. With the introduction of the State of Jefferson concept, it became clear that many Northern Californians are thinking of seceding from Southern California and creating a new state, which would include Yuba County, California, up to Douglas County, Oregon. The State of Jefferson would allow Northern Californians to have a smaller government that would reflect Northern Californian values and implement more personal freedoms. In Northern California, we focus more on agriculture, we are also more family-oriented, and we are much more conservative. Whereas Southern California is focused on industry, the superficial Hollywood life, along with the fact that they are more liberal, according to appeal.com. NorCal provides food and water transportation to SoCal, but all they provide us with is Hollywood and movies and inconsistent industrial activity. With the State of Jefferson, Northern California would be able to provide for our own needs first before providing for the needs of other states. The politician William Jennings Bryan once said that, "Take away the cities and leave the agriculture. The cities will flourish again due to the agriculture." This would connect to the concept of the Northern Californians being represented in their own smaller government, where their own needs would be heard on a closer, more conservative level. The needs of Northern Californians should not be interrupted by higher population sectors who do not represent what Northern Californians need in a smaller government. More personal freedoms could also be implemented with the introduction of the state of Jefferson. California is currently ranked 49 out of 50 in personal freedoms according to ranksofstates.com. The government could not regulate, the government regulates California's government harsher than any other state government does, and it also aggressively interferes with California state citizens' lives. With the state of Jefferson, NorCal citizens would have less government intervention in business and personal life matters. They would be able to take matters into their own hands and receive more personal freedoms in the long run. In conclusion, the state of Jefferson should be taken into deep consideration because it would allow for smaller government that would reflect a Northern Californian's values and would allow for more personal freedoms. Thank you.
Good evening, guys. Thank you for having me here. My name is Asghar Khan from Lido High School. I also participate in the Lido FFA chapter. And I'd like to thank you guys for having me here tonight. An issue I'd like to propose to you is the heavy traffic in the school mornings of the city of Lido. I am very confident that if you ask anyone living in Lido, they would agree with me that traffic is a major issue. There have been numerous accidents throughout the past year, specifically on Pennington Road and the enter and exit routes at our schools in the Lido Oak Unified School District. For instance, at the Luther Elementary School, a little boy in kindergarten suffered minor injuries after crossing a crosswalk and being hit by a vehicle, a 2006 Toyota. And at that same crosswalk, a child with his grandmother was also struck by a vehicle. And for me, I believe this is very disappointing to know that even with a guardian crossing the road, we're still not safe crossing the crosswalk. Luckily, none of these accidents that have occurred were fatal or life-threatening. After evaluating these accidents, I have come to a solution. My first solution is informing the students and their parents about crossing any road safely, either by sending an informational letter or have a school event specifically talking about the issue. Another solution is improving road conditions on Pennington Road and implementing more street signs to warn drivers of the students crossing. And I really do not believe that crosswalks are sometimes ineffective. These crosswalks are like the safest way for pedestrians to cross the road. I believe that the main reasons that drivers can't, drivers are not noticing these students crossing the road is because they're speeding. So basically, what I want to do is have more obstacles for these speeding drivers, such as speed bumps, cross workers to help children cross the roads. And I understand that the city's already placed crosswalks specifically to warn drivers. They have little lights on the bottom to specifically warn them. But nearly 50 students from my Punjabi class in middle school, we walked to the Lido High School, and that's the bus is broken. When we cross, we use an ineffective and broken crosswalkway every day. And this is why I take this opportunity to explain this issue while I have the chance to inform you guys. Because that is one of the main reasons why these accidents occur today. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Katie Patrick and I'm a sophomore at Sutter Union High School. I'm here today to speak to you on behalf of the Sutter County Animal Shelter. The Sutter County Animal Service Authority, or Animal Shelter for short, has for years provided a safe and humane way to help rescue and care for homeless animals. And thanks to the cooperation between the Board of Supervisors and two different cities, Lido and Yuba City, a brand new state-of-the-art facility has been built, providing a better and much more improved way to shelter dogs and cats. But dogs and cats are not the only species that need shelter. We live in a very rural part of the state where farming and ranching livestock are really common. Having livestock as pets is common as well too. Just as dogs and cats get out or are surrendered to the shelter, livestock pets are too. But at the moment, there is no facility in place to put these animals. I learned that just this past month, three separate cases have come up involving two different horses and a goat that needed to be picked up and housed. Therefore, it is time for the animal shelter to build a livestock and large animal barn. Fortunately, plans are already in place to do just that. It's estimated that the cost of construction for a barn would be around $40,000, with another $10,000 needed for plumbing and heating, so a grand total of around $50,000. But I'm happy to report that fundraising efforts done by the newly formed nonprofit organization called Friends of the Sutter County Animal Services has nearly two-thirds of their funding goal met, around $35,000. The director of the animal shelter, Diana Barrett, in my interview with her, told me that she's overwhelmed by the support of the public and projects the goal to be reached for construction to begin in 2 years. It is great to know that the shelter has such support from the area's governing entities and the citizens of this town. However, 2 years is a long way away, and the problem isn't immediate. For example, if the animal shelter picks up a large animal, the animal is put into makeshift panel and hose pens. Humane, yes, but without any forms or covering or protection from the elements, the animals are at risk of getting loose, hurting themselves, or putting others in harm's way. And a lot of times, if they're out of shelter in the first place, they're pretty good escapees. In addition, the large animals that come through the shelter, such as horses, donkeys, mules, pigs, sheep, goats, and even emu, have all come from rural parts of the county and are not usually from within city limits. Therefore, it's more of a problem for rural Sutter County. So today, I'm going to ask you to help with the immediate funds to supplement the construction of the barn so that construction can begin right away. Although the public will eventually come through to reach a financial goal, your immediate assistance, even in the form of a loan, will get this project on its way and help keep livestock from rural Sutter County safe. Please consider looking into this further and soon. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Warren Jones. I'm 16 years old and a student at Lilac High School. Ladies and gentlemen, first, I would like to thank you for the opportunity to speak before you. Second, I would like to inform you of some very important news. The average age of farmers is advancing rapidly. 70.4% of the farming population is age 51 and older. Only 9.7% of that population is over the age of 70. With our entire lifestyle, economy, and well-being dependent on whether agriculturalists can produce food, what do you think the effects will be if 50% of the American farmers retire or disappear in the next 20 years? Now, the supply of food will probably always meet our needs, but over the last century, the number of farmers has decreased rapidly, causing farming to become more cooperative than family. Small-scale farms retain better morales, keep family values, and keep a positive atmosphere. The issue I'm presenting you is much larger than Sutter County, or even the state of California, in fact. It is nationwide. But the action we can take here at home can help combat this problem. Here's where we can start. Advocating agriculture for youth is the most important step we can take in order to secure our future. Being a student with the intention of having a career in agriculture, I have found that there are many students, members of the FFA, the Future Farmers of America, along with 4-H'ers, who will be willing to provide the willpower necessary to implant gardens, run farm days, and work towards a more effective ag education for local elementary schools. As with all good ways to fund the cause, there should be no gaps. That is why the FFA started the Powers Program. It encourages teenagers to help connect younger students to agricultural opportunities and help spark an interest for their futures. The Powers Program makes sure that you're not simply throwing money at the organization, but instead funding this movement directly. The Powers Program helps teenagers gain job experience, assume leadership roles, while elementary children can learn and grow to appreciate agriculture. By implementing gardens in local schools, we can spark an interest that will benefit the nation or even the world. As the FFA creed has taught me, I believe in the future of agriculture with a faith born out of words, but of deeds. Thank you for your consideration.
My name is Harpreet Lani, and I'm currently a sophomore at Sutter Union High School. Today, I will be encouraging the advertisement of museum funds and sharing with you some acumen as to why museums are essential to our modern society. Numerous people seem to conceive that museums are just places where old and irrelevant objects are located. This, however, is very apocryphal. Museums provide a unique and attractive experience of getting close up to impedimenta we usually only see in books, newspapers, or television. The perception you get of something from a secondhand source often is completely different to the one you get when you see something with your own eyes. Museums can bring what we learn to school to life, attract many tourists to our city, and last but not least, give you the experience of a lifetime. However, museums in our area are not being used to their full potential and require more funding than they are currently being given. The Mary Aaron Memorial Museum of Yuba City has an annual revenue estimate of $3,267 and only 2 employees. The California Cultural Museum and Memorial has an annual revenue of $120,000 and only 4 employees. Both of these museums have annual revenues that are not even half of what the average museum in our area should be making. After I learned about this, I decided to take a survey. I asked 20 students ranging from 9th to 12th grade the question, can you name one museum in our area? Only 3 students of 20 interviewed had an answer. That's about 15% of students being able to name a single museum in our area. If museums have the correct fundings, they would be able to get out to the public more and have a huge chunk of our community involved in many museum activities. Museums can provide anything from reaching out and providing foster children with new experiences, teens and college students a great opportunity to take in culture, and families a great day of learning. More funding for Sutter County museums can and will create a whole new experience for the entire community. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Matthew Finley from Sutter Union High School. Today I want to talk to you about Jefferson. He was the principal author for our country's Declaration of Independence. He was a founding father who had a dream and a vision for the way this new land should exist and prosper. He was a great man, and now his name will serve as the title of a great state. That's right, the state of Jefferson, not just the state of mind. Sutter County needs to be a part of it. If you'll take a look at the map behind you, you'll see that these are the election results from the general election in 2012. If Jefferson was a state, which you can see by the black line which represents its borders, if Jefferson was a state, no doubt it would have gone red. Unfortunately, this area is divided and attached to 2 liberal states that vote democratically by majority. The majority of Northern Californians, though, voted for a Republican president. But because the masses of people in cities like San Francisco and Los Angeles did not, all 55 of our electoral votes went to President Obama. Similarly, in Oregon, all 7 of their electoral votes went to Obama as well, even though a big amount of 43% of their people did not vote for President Obama. Why should our votes get overshadowed again and again? Why don't our votes matter in this state? They should, and they can if we secede from California. At least if we were the state of Jefferson, some of those votes would go to our chosen candidate instead of all 62 of them going to the other side. But it's not just our president. Sutter County did not elect Jerry Brown to be our governor. But because the majority of Californians did, namely those south of the Jefferson border, there he sits as our governor. But Jerry Brown has done damage to the state. He is hurting our families and our children. Take, for example, the high-speed rail. That is a project that is going to cost the state $68 billion, money that we don't have and we shouldn't spend. Why can't our governor redirect those funds into our roads because the majority of Californians drive cars? It doesn't make sense. But we're not just adopting California's bad leaders, we're adopting their bad policies as well. California's income tax is among the highest in the country. Its sales tax is still higher than the majority of other states. And simultaneously, California gives $25 billion to illegal immigrants every year. And why shouldn't Northern California get to control where our water goes? Why is the governor funding for a $25 billion project that will send all of our water down south, causing environmental problems? We can't afford to be part of California's failing policies and corrupt administration anymore. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Abigail Davis and I'm from Live Oak FFA. And tonight I will be speaking about the importance of the county fair in Sutter County. Our county fair is essential for teaching youth exhibitors in 4-H, FFA, as well as independent showmen, responsibility, aspects of business management, and work ethic. From the beginning of their project journey, they begin to learn responsibility it takes to care for animals, whether it's a lamb, goat, hog, steer, poultry, birds, or rabbits. Students are responsible for such activities like feeding, watering, making sure the health of their animal is good, and working with their animals. Through these responsibilities, students learn proper animal management and care. Along with responsibility, our county fair gives exhibitors a chance to learn business management. When dealing with the financial aspects of a fair project, students learn responsible financial practices, considering that they have a limited budget to buy the animal, feed, and medicine. That they are accountable for any loans received on behalf of their animal, which will be paid full upon the sale, all while investing the money for their next future project. This is a simple but essential skill which tremendously benefits the youth in Sutter County. It's a skill that can and will benefit the youth entering the adult world. Our county fair gives youth a chance to show livestock, which teaches students a sense of work ethic and pride. After spending the summer feeding, watering, exercising, practicing showmanship, and caring for their animal, students learn to always put forth the best effort when starting with an untamed animal. Exhibitors must put long hours towards familiarizing the animal with them as well as practicing showmanship. County fairs give an opportunity to demonstrate the hard work that's put forth to projects. From showmanship, market, all the way to the auction, exhibitors show the community the outcome of their hard work and determination. Without our county fair, hundreds of students wouldn't learn responsibility, business management, and work ethic. Our county fair is essential for the success of youth in our county. Please continue to support our county fair by advocating for it, purchasing animals from exhibitors, and by volunteering to keep it alive and thriving. Thank you for your time.
Hi, my name is Ella Harrison, and I'm so glad to be invited here tonight. My plan is to incorporate more green belts all throughout Sutter County. More bike and walking trails provide multiple services to our community. One of the factors that makes a city desirable to those looking for new homes is the availability of bike trails. If people are able to walk to their favorite stores and restaurants without having to bother with traffic or hustle, they might be more interested in buying a home here. A recent article by the Delaware Department of Transportation states, studies and surveys have shown that bicycle paths, trails, and greenways can contribute to areas where they are established by providing recreation, transportation, a sense of community, increased property values, and lower crime. If our county would consider creating more bike and walking trails, we would also see a tremendous change in the health of our citizens. Bicycling and walking are excellent forms of exercise. We would see obesity and diabetes decrease, helping us to change the way our citizens look, feel, and act towards each other. I understand and admit that creating these new trails would be expensive. This is a valid point. However, research shows that if there are fewer cars on the road, the investment would actually save money in the long run. Car owners must spend money on gas, maintenance, car insurance, the cost of purchasing the vehicle, taxes, and vehicle registration fees. This does not even take into account the need for expensive road upkeep by the county due to vehicle use. This money would be used elsewhere in our community if our community would choose to ride bicycles or walk. A way to execute this plan would be to connect all cultural centers together throughout the Sutter counties. In a few key places, this might mean building a small overpass over a busy street to provide safe access, but for the most part, it can be done cheaply by weaving trails through open areas. In Yuba City, for example, where there is already a rails-to-trails path, the existing trail could simply be extended through a mostly open field to connect to a large population area west of town with the Walmart shopping center. Imagine the impact if even half the residents west of that large shopping area would abandon their cars for 1 to 2 trips per week. All in all, the creation of more green belts and bike paths would help tremendously with the environment, our city's attractiveness and approval rating, with our health and with our economy. If we create viable pathways between shopping, dining, and cultural centers, then people would reach for the bicycles more.